His Excellency, Mr. Ambassador, Honorable Rector, distinguished guests, thank you for attending this afternoon the second session of the Ambassador Talk, which is organized by the International Relations Office in collaboration with the Department of Social and Political Sciences and International Relations of the International University of Sarajevo. Before proceeding with today's program, I would like to give you a glimpse of the Ambassador's biography. His Excellency, Mr. Hideo Yamazaki, was born in 1956 in the city of Kobe, which is famous for its Kobe beef. In Japan. Now, he graduated from Osaka University from the Faculty of Economics in 1979 and joined the cabinet in that same year. He studied economics in Essex University in the UK from 1983 and studied statistics in London School of Economics, the LSE, in 1984. He worked for the Embassy of Japan in Washington, D.C. as the first secretary from 1990 to 1993. He experienced many positions in the Cabinet Office and the Ministry of Management and Coordination. In charge of the Document Management Act and under Prime Minister Fukuda in 2008. And in 2011, the ambassador became the ambassador to Bosnia and Herzegovina. Now, without further ado, I'd like to invite Mr. Ambassador, His Excellency, to deliver his talk.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Yamazaki. I came here in Sarajevo in October 2011. So it is already 2 years and 5 months. Basically, I like Bosnia very much. I think, you know, Bosnian people are very friendly. And I also like Bosnian food very much, cebab cici or donuts. And you know, I have staying in Washington D.C. and in London, but I feel here, you know, as a mixture, feeling of mixture of East and West. So I think I can feel relaxed, you know, here, more than you know, in London or in Washington D.C. London and Washington D.C. is also a nice place. But you know, in a sense, it's a bit difficult to get a feeling of relaxed. So I'm now enjoying it. Today, I'd like to speak to you about Japanese culture and economic success in Japan. Modern Japan began in 1868. At the time of Meiji Restoration, and not revolution, we could change Japan from samurai society to modern society without civil war. So I think it's a good example, competitive to French Revolution. We could change our society very peacefully. And then Japan won two wars, you know, Japan-Sino-War, Japan-China War in 1894, and the Japan-Russia War in 1904. During Japan-Russia War, as you may know, Japan defeated Russian Baltic Fleet completely. So I had that at that time, it was astonished by world people. And it became, you know, hope in a sense, hope for the people in developing countries. But unfortunately, Japan defeated in World War II. But after the World War II, we recovered from ruins in very short time. In fact, we became the second biggest economic giant in the world in 1968, 24 years after the ceasefire and 100 years after Meiji restoration. Okay, so this happened exactly 100 years after the Meiji Restoration. Since I arrived here 2 years ago, I have had the pleasure to speak with many people in BIH, and I was surprised by the great interest in Japanese culture despite the distance between our countries. Japan has been supporting Bosnia about 1 billion marka, 1 billion KM since 1996. Someone asked me why Japan is supporting this country, because Japan is very far from here. I always answer that, you know, Japan has the same history, same memory, the devastation, recovery from the devastation. That is the reason, you know, why Japan has been supporting this country. Okay, let's speak about culture. It is a known fact that our society and culture are significantly different from US. However, when I'm walking around Bastarchia, as I said earlier, I feel that Bosnian culture is a mixture of both Europe and Orient, West and East. It's good. I'm enjoying the life in Sarajevo very much. As I understand, as students who are interested in different cultures, you have probably heard about the samurai, samurai or kabuki. I have to say, modern Japanese people are quite different from samurai. You can't find samurai in Japan anymore. And many people don't see kabuki so much. Japanese are not exactly identical to European culture. Is different from place to place. So it could be said that a modern Japanese identity represents a combination of the traditional values of history, moral obligation, harmony, respect toward nature and globalism, urban spirit. So this is why I believe people in BIH are interested in our culture very much. So Japanese culture has a mixture of both sides, traditional Japan and modern Western world. So I'd like to talk about key characteristics of Japanese society and culture. Let me see. For example, this is Mount Fuji, the most famous mountain in Japan, and it was registered as World Heritage last year. And I'd like to speak about annual events, you know. At first, let me touch upon annual events in Japan. Perhaps the most famous example of this kind is Hanami. Hanami is Japanese, cherry blossom viewing party. Now I'm happy to find many cherry blossoms are in full bloom across Sarajevo. Cherry blossom is the most popular flowers in Japan. The custom in Japan in March and April. Okay, the custom in Japan in March and April, when the cherry blossoms are in full bloom, is for people to spread a mat under the cherry blossom and take a cup of, you know, Japanese sake, not rakia, Japanese sake or beer. This festival is, you know, very famous. So if you go to Japan as a beginning of April, and you can find, you know, many people enjoying themselves by drinking a cup of Japanese wine sake or Japanese beer under the cherry blossom trees. So I recommend you to go to Japan in April or in November. You know, you can enjoy the changing color of leaves. It's very popular and very beautiful. So cherry blossom viewing party is very famous and one spot of our culture. And you know, during the autumn, the moon becomes very beautiful. So full moon, at the time of full moon in autumn, we are going to have moon viewing parties. You know, we also drink a cup of sake by viewing. But you know, it's the same of Bosnia. You know, you are often. Take a cup of rakia. It's similar. So, you know, this stands for, you know, the harmony with the nature. I like the nature, the harmony with mankind and nature. And next, I'd like to talk about Shinto or shrine archways. Shinto is one of our religions. Like Christianity or Buddhism. I'll stress that some of the ancient customary practice of Shinto remains as a part of the modern life in Japan. For example, before the construction of the building, even if the building is to be a modern structure, we always erect a simple bamboo frame. Which serves as a temporary Shinto altar or Shinto shrine. Shinto means literally the way of the gods. It is a Japanese religion dating from ancient times, centering on the idea of Japanese intimacy with nature and ancestor worship. So some people say that Japanese religion, Shinto, is very primitive. But it is because we admire the nature. It is our thinking that every natural being, mountain, forest, and a big river has the god inside it. So Shinto means literally is the way of the god. It is a Japanese religion dating from ancient times, as I said. And so Shinto priest is called in at the time of constructing. Shinto priest is called in, and prayers of appeasement are offered to the gods for benevolence and the safety of construction workers. However, this doesn't imply that Japanese are religious people. Japanese weddings are often conducted according to either Shinto ceremony or Christian ceremony. While funerals are usually carried out according to Buddhist practice, to some people, or even to Bosnian people, this mixing of religious elements seems as strange as would be the unlikely practice of blending religions. You know, it is like the mixture of Islamic wedding with a Christian funeral. But in fact, since ancient times, we have had a tradition of polytheism, which means that all things on earth were brought forth and ruled over by the gods who reside throughout all nature. I should be careful to say, but in a sense, unitheism is a bit dangerous, In unitheism means that, the people who doesn't believe in the same God is enemy, and it led to crusaders in a medieval area. Of course, nowadays, people, understanding each other, so such conflict seldom occurs. In Japan, we don't put much emphasis on religion. We are respecting other religion, each other. Next, I'd like to talk about the nature. As you can imagine, understanding the attitude of Japanese people towards nature is very important. You already know now that nature represents the central element of our annual events and our religion practice as well. In some Western countries, it is a good idea to conquer nature, to overcome the difficulty of nature and conquer nature. But Japanese people like the harmony with the nature. You know, a human being is one element of nature, and we have to respect nature, and we have to, you know, put emphasis on the harmony with the nature. It is totally different from the idea of some Western countries. So Japanese view of nature is based on three fundamental elements. First of all, for Japanese people, the nature is not constant or static, but temporary and changing, like ever-ending cycle of seasons. Like fluid movement filled with the power of creation. It reflects the view of the world as transitional era, not permanent, ever changing. Let me quote a line which sum up this attitude, beast. Ceaselessly the river flows, and yet the water is never the same. It is a story from the famous poet in medieval era. Nature is not constant, changing, ever changing. And secondly, Japanese believe that nature constrains an element of harmony in spite of its violence, as I told earlier. In every natural landscape, in mountains, rivers, trees, and seas, there is a living God. A God founded on the premise of truth. Harmony and togetherness are very important characteristics of our culture. And thirdly, Japanese do not view nature in opposition to mankind or as an object which man can conquer, as I told earlier. Instead, we believe that man lives harmoniously with nature. We can live in harmony with the nature, or that nature exists on the same level as mankind, a level marked by a mutual respect, love, or even emotional response. So nature is a friend of many Japanese people. There have been so many natural disasters in Japan, like earthquakes and typhoon. So today is the third year, of the recent big earthquake occurred in 2011. Japanese people are appreciating Bosnian people because they gave much donation to Japanese people. We have realized that we cannot conquer the nature. Instead of opposing it, Japanese prefer to live in close common with nature, obeying its rules. You might think that the significance of the individual is denied here, but it is not so. Friends who gather to enjoy music may one day grow distant from each other, but those who have shared the experience of reaching oneness with nature by seeing cherry blossoms over a cup of Japanese sake. It's experience. Even though they depart, they may meet each other, in 10 years later or 20 years later. Okay, let's start. Next, I'd like to talk about Japanese garden. Honestly speaking, Japanese culture is very complicated. So I don't think you can understand every aspect of Japanese culture. But I hope that you can feel the atmosphere of Japanese culture. As a final example, I'd like to mention about the Japanese garden. In general, Japanese garden is designed to reflect the nature as it exists. At times, however, rocks and trees have been added in an artificial arrangement aimed at improving on nature by rendering it more natural. In traditional European and Islamic cultures, gardens adopted geometric patterns, you know, which express the order of human spirit. In Europe, a garden was also viewed as an appendage to a building, appendix to a building, playing a sort of supporting role. This is a contrast to the Japanese garden, which is always given the leading role in architecture process. It is a garden which is of foremost importance, as in Japan, a garden and its natural elements are thought to contain a cosmic truth. It is commonly understood that a Japanese garden reached its full bloom of beauty at least 5 years after its construction, and sometimes even 50 years after the construction. In this respect, it is not the man who creates the garden, but nature creates the garden. So before I move to economic development in Japan, I'd like to make the final comment on Japanese culture. I have explained our culture with elements as simple as possible. We are set today to be in the age of globalization. But I think it doesn't mean that all cultures should be homogenized, or that some cultures should be judged better than others. Instead, globalization is an opportunity to better understanding the respective differences of other cultures in order to eliminate, you know, misunderstandings. So I think, you know, respecting other culture is very important, especially in Bosnia, you know, three ethnic groups or Muslims that are living together. So in this sense, feeling towards culture in Bosnia is similar to Japanese attitude, you know, respect each other. And respect other religions, you know. Okay, let me move on into the economic part of the lecture. The World War II, which ended in 1945, caused a total devastation of Japan. It is almost the same as, you know, 1995 in this country. But, you know, more than that, because many buildings in Japan are made from wood, so most of buildings were burned. So in a sense, devastation was much serious than here in 1995. The human loss amounted to 3.1 million, big number. The material loss amounted to about the quarter of the entire national wealth. So one-fourth, a quarter of GDP disappeared, you know. And industrial product dropped to one-tenth of 10% of the pre-war level. As you may know very well, afterwards, Japan rapidly recovered itself from the ruins of war to become one of the most developed countries in the world. Which is sometimes referred to as miracle recovery. Now Japan is the third largest economy in the world, next to United States and China. But China has huge population, so per capita GNI is only 10% in China compared with Japan. But you know, in total GNP, China is the second. There are so many factors which enable this miraculous recovery, and numerous studies have been done. To fully understand this phenomenon, you'll need to enroll in the specialized degree program in Japanese economy. Japanese government is Embassy of Japan is sending two scholarship students every year, most of them made a great success in Japan. If some of you are interested in studying in Japan after this university's course, please make an application. I think you can find the application form from the website of our embassy. So if you can study a 2 years master course in Japan, you can understand, you know, the reason of Japanese development. So it may be difficult to speak in a short time, so I'd like to explain, just outline, you know. And there are so many factors which enable this recovery, you know. But as I told earlier, you should study a diploma or a master course in Japan to fully understand this growth. But regarding, you know, macroeconomy, firstly, I'd like to briefly mention the post-war macroeconomic policy as well as external factors which contributed to the economic recovery. The post-World War II Japanese economic development was a process of catch up, you know, catching up to the other industrialized economy in America and Europe. Economic policies and corporate strategies were geared towards this utmost objective, catching up with the West. So, you know, there was a model, you know, to catch up. So it was good. As a result, the Japanese monetary policy was focused on providing funds to strategic sectors, you know, which had the potential to compete globally. To overcome the shortage of saving in the banking system after the war. So after the war, we had we didn't have much money. So the Japanese government heavily injected, you know, its public assets in strategic industries, steel, coal mining, electricity, shipbuilding, and other infrastructure, you know, making road or railways. It was a good for, you know, restart Japanese economy. And this enables the reconstruction of the backbone of Japanese economic system. And external factors was good at that time for Japan. It is also worthwhile to mention the external factors which have contributed to the development of Japanese economy. I think Japan was lucky because industry protection was still the norm at the world level after the war. Now, you know, it's difficult to put, you know, severe restriction to importing goods. But at that time, we can put tariff to, you know, many, to American cars, or German cars, and so on. So now BIH doesn't put any customs to vehicles from EU countries, but I think BIH government are putting, you know, 30% of customs for Japanese cars. So it's one of the reasons, you know, why you cannot find many Japanese cars here. So it's a good, you know, to start, but I can't find, you know, any vehicles made in BIH. So if you want to make BIH vehicles, it is good, you know, to put some customs to foreign vehicles. That is the way Japan did as a beginning of the recovery. And there were different kind of protection measures in practice. In addition to customs or tariffs, government could also apply a quantitative restriction, its own industrial standards and so on. So in order to protect its own infant industry. So, you know, at that time, any kind of restriction are permitted to protect infant industry. In early stage of the post-war recovery, the goal of the occupation of Japan by the United States, Japan was occupied by the United States and its allies for 8 years, from 1945 and 53. And in the early stage of that occupation, the aim of United States and its allies was to prevent Japan from regaining military power. Therefore, a full recovery of heavy industries was not encouraged in the early stage of the occupation. However, as the Cold War worsened, socialist countries and Western countries was in some kind of confrontation after the Second World War, as you know, and its Cold War. The United States attitude gradually shifted to allow and actively support Japan to re-industrialize and to become an independent economy to counter the increasing threat from the Soviet Union. So international circumstances was lucky for Japan at that time to rebuild industries, especially heavy industries. And also the Korean War, which broke out in 1950, 5 years after the Second World War, resulted in high demand for military supplies from nearby Japan and triggered rapid reconstruction of the Japanese economy. As a result, by 1952, Japan restored the real GDP level to a level comparable with that of 1935, just before the Second World War. So in that sense, we accomplished the pre-war level in less than 10 years, in just 7 years. Next, I'd like to mention about technological development. I think Kaizen is very popular, and quality control in Japan is, very popular worldwide. And this is a reason of the major reason of development in Japan. Many people speak about Japanese workers. They are working very hard, and they are doing overtime every day, and so on. I think workers in BIH is very industrious, and for example, their construction work is very good, I think. But it seems to me they are not good at work systematically, last year in June, we saw the reconstruction of tram railway. I think the result is good, and their construction work is very good. But one day, suddenly, they blocked all road to that tram road. So I couldn't go to the embassy on the first day of construction work. In Japan, they blocked half of road so that some vehicles can pass each one by one. But here, they suddenly broke all part. And in Japan, workers will work during nighttime. During nighttime, so it's easier for them to construct. But here, they work only during daytime, and they didn't do work during at night. I don't think it's not efficient, and so on. So I think that Bosnian people are very nice and very industrious. And I don't think Bosnian people are lazy at all. But compared with Japanese workers, they are not working they are not good at working systematically, you know, cooperating each other or cooperate with other sections. It's a problem, I think. I think if Bosnian people can overcome this, the productivity will be much higher. There is a, you know, interesting joke talking about, you know, Japanese workers or Japanese method of making parts. For example, this is a joke, you know. The American automaker company placed an order of brake pedal to an auto parts company of a certain country, and a Japanese company with delivery date of 20 days. The pedal was to be manufactured in accordance with the attached specification, with product defect rate 1 out of 100,000, you know. So 1 out of 100,000 default can be permitted. It's very strict, you know. A company of a certain country immediately emailed to American company saying that deadline was too strict and asked the delivery rate to be postponed. We can't do that. It's too strict. The condition is too strict. But Japanese company also emailed immediately to American company saying that the delivery date was fine, acceptable, and they received the specification for the pedal. But the specification for defective products was not attached. Please send it immediately, otherwise we cannot produce defective product. We can produce, you know, even defective product precisely according to the order. That is a one joke. The advancement of Japanese technology did not happen in one night. Japan has had a long history of technological development. The Japanese artisan, Japanese experts, invented the first wooden robots called Karakuri Ningyo in the 17th century. So we made robot, you know, made of wood, even in 17th century. This is a door, you know, to serve a teapot to the guest. It's a kind of a robot. And however, the rapid advancement of technology came in the 19th century. Immediately after the collapse of Tokugawa Shogun, you know, in 1868, the change from samurai society to modern society. The newly established Meiji government embarked on the path of rapid modernization and westernization of Japan. In that period, the leader adopted the new Western-based education system for all young people and dispatched thousands of students to the United States and Europe and hired more than 3,000 Western teachers. The introduction of Western technologies coupled with the long tradition of Japanese artisans' attention into details enables the rapid technology development. But you know, we have a tradition of technology. We made robot even in 17 centuries. And we invited, you know, a good foreign teacher to teach young people. That mixture enabled the rapid development of Japan in very short time. So I think it's important to, you know, invite foreign teachers or foreign technicians to learn about economy and technology. So by the beginning of the World War II in 1941, Japan has developed the fastest and most capable fighter plane, Mitsubishi Zero. You may have heard of it, Zero Fighter. It was very popular at the beginning of the Second World War. And Grumman and Lockheed, Japanese and American company, dispatched the destroyed aircraft and imitate And they made better fighter jets at the last phase of the Second World War. So Zero fighter was not the highest at the end of the Second World War. But anyway, Japan made such kind of good fighter and good warship called Yamato Musashi. It was the biggest warship at that time. But unfortunately, Japanese economy was not so strong as American economy. So Japan cannot produce many fighter planes. So the time was changed to, you know, warship versus warship battle to aircraft to aircraft battle. So that's the reason that Japan was defeated. So anyway, also we made a great success 50 years after Meiji restriction. But after that, some politicians made many mistakes, and Japan was defeated in the Second World War. Okay, next, I'd like to speak about unique Japanese style business practice. There are three principles in Japanese business style. First, customize God, you know, customize always right. It is our policy. It is a policy of Japanese companies or businessmen. Sometimes I encounter the situation in Europe where customers and shop owners were exchanging bitter words over some particular product. The customer's preference was on a certain product and the shop didn't handle it. That kind of merchandise. So instead of saying, oh, sorry, I don't have it, the owner talked about negative aspects of the product, preaching to the customer. So the customer felt fooled. It had the customer proud. Or on some other occasions, shopkeepers would say high-handedly to the customer, take it or leave it. Here, zeal, enthusiasm for selling the products wasn't seen. If I were the customer, I would certainly tell my friends about this and told them never to go there, never to go to the shop. The shop owners are not kind. If it happened in Japan, such shop would go bankruptcy very soon. First of all, you cannot dedicate customer to buy at your shop. This person is entirely free to do shop or at free to do shop at any other place. So shop owners should be careful not to hurt the emotion of customers. And secondly, you may not make business with this person today, but he or she may be a future customer. You know, she or he may not buy today. But, you know, he or she may buy from you in a couple of days after. So all customers are future customers. So in Japan, shop owners behave, you know, as if all customers are friends and future friends. This is, the characteristics. So first principle is customize God. Customize always correct, right. And second principle, sacrifice yourself for your credibility. Let's say that a company won a competition and got a job for construction of bridge under a certain condition. The delay was, you know, too many, the delay occurred because of heavy rain. But in case of companies of other country, they make many excuses for delay. But in Japanese case, you know, workers do everything. They don't escape from overtime work. and company are not escaped from, you know, adding, paying extra money, and their construct in time. It may be lost, you know, the company may not gain the profit from that construction, but they have a chance to get another construction for future, and they can earn profit. They can get profit from the future project. So, long time perspective is very important in Japanese business. So you have to think of, you know, next 5 years or 10 years. And third principle is teamwork. You know, it is common. I was working in London or Washington D.C. and I visited many government offices. Many persons, most of people are, you know, working by himself or herself alone in private room. But in Japan, if many people are working in the same room, this is too big, even for Japanese companies. But you know, many people, directors and assistant directors, or section chief and workers, they are working in the same room. So they can share the information each other. So if one person have to take a leave, he or she doesn't have to explain too much for the substitute, for neighbors. All people can understand, you know, how the progress of work is. So and they can share their work of the total team. So it's easy to accomplish, you know, to product. In very short time. This is a teamwork of Japanese companies. It's important. These three characteristics is you know, main reason why Japan made a great success in after the Second World War. I think, you know, BIH, Bosnia and Herzegovina has chance to further development. But the problem for me is, I've been talking to many Bosnian people and Bosnian professors. Oh, they are very serious and good. But I think that some politicians are not very good in democracy. In democracy, politicians should think of people, citizens. But here, some politicians are just thinking of their post, how long they can take post. It's not a democracy. So I hope situation will be changed. Recently, I found many protests from citizens. It is understandable, but protests should be done peacefully. Without obstructing other people. But it is a basic right of democracy. So I hope that this movement will lead to good result to the real democracy of this country. So I think political stability is very important. I'm trying to invite many Japanese companies to Bosnia. There are some companies, Toyota, Sony, Panasonic, but you know, without political stability, Japanese companies will not come to Bosnia. So I hope, I think Bosnia will have a general election in this October. So I hope that further political stability will be secured in this country. So this is just a briefing of, you know, Japanese economy, and it is very difficult to make you know, in short time. But I hope that you can smell the culture, you can feel the atmosphere of Japanese culture and Japanese economy. Is there any questions? If you have any questions, I can answer. Please.
Could you discuss the education? I'm from the United States, but here we share, we were at London School of Economics. Mm-hmm. Always there was great respect for Japanese workmanship. Mm-hmm. And always, but the West beat their chest, especially mm-hmm. Anglo-Saxon, about creativity. Mm-hmm. Could you comment on that, how you feel mm-hmm. Japan on that? Mm-hmm. And the second question to your big neighbor just next to you, how do you view your relations and how that's going to progress, the Obama's pivot to the West and you and China mm-hmm. and everybody. Mm-hmm. We can stay here till midnight.
Mm-hmm. thank you very much. It's a big question. So I think it takes hours to answer it. But you know, regarding your first question, education, Japanese education put much emphasis on memorizing, you know. When America discovered, when is the French Revolution? So it's good, you know, in a manufacturing society, you know. We are, you know, farmers. Most of the Japanese were farmers in medieval era. So putting seeds together, cultivating together, and cutting harvest together. So we are good at, you know, we are good at incorporating with other person. And education is uniformity, has uniformity. So in Japanese education, they didn't put much emphasis on creativity. That is, I think, the problem of nowadays. Now, you know, manufacturer, society of manufacture of over, and creativity is more important to develop the country. Of course, Japanese government are changing their education, to put much emphasis on creativity. But I don't think it's enough. Japanese education was very good or almost perfect to develop manufacturing society. But you know, we have to change a little bit to put much emphasis on creativity. Japanese government is now doing that. And regarding the second question, Japan and China has a very close relation economically. You know, Japan is exporting most from China, and China is exporting the second next to United States from Japan. But unfortunately, in political field, we have some kind of stress. I hope that, you know, Chinese government and the top politicians of Chinese government and Prime Minister Abe can talk each other to overcome the issues. For example, regarding Senkaku Island, Japan has been controlling that island more than 100 years ago. But China claimed in 1990s, after the possibility of oil seed was found in the region. And that is our stance. But the Chinese government has another stance. They are claiming that, you know, Japan are stealed from China during Japan Sino-War War. But it is not correct in our view. So anyway, I think Prime Minister Abe and Chinese top official top politician should talk to each other.
Okay, can I? Yeah, I have two short comments. First thing, I would like to express my personal and I believe mutual gratitude for the given lecture. This university has hosted many lectures so far in this, how long I'm here, I don't know, 2-3 years, and how I see it, how I believe it, that you are the most cheerful one. It was a real pleasure to listen to you. And the second thing is, what I admire Japanese society is the thing that you have called sort of like social responsibility to society. Mm-hmm. I read an article, I don't know whether is it true, but I find it like accurate. I believe it's true that some few years back in Tokyo, a train operator who was operating the metro in Tokyo was late, mm-hmm. I think 5 or 7 minutes. Mm-hmm. Afterwards, when like passengers complained, mm-hmm. he resigned, the first thing they resigned, and whether you believe it or not, then he committed harakiri, which is quite obvious.
Regarding harakiri, I don't think it's true.
Yeah. I mean, that was the comment, mm-hmm. but I believe that he resigned. Mm-hmm. Here in Bosnia, unfortunately, I have to disagree with you on this point that mm-hmm. our workers are the same. Mm-hmm. Maybe those like builders or something, mm-hmm. but the people who govern this country, the administration, they are nowhere similar. Mm-hmm. I mean, mm-hmm. you have total obligation to your society mm-hmm. while we have zero. And there is no collective concern about the future mm-hmm. of this society country, while Japan, I think, is the prime example mm-hmm. of a collective-like concern.
Thank you very much. It is true that if you are in Tokyo, we is as often hear the announcement in metro. I'm sorry, this metro is 2 minutes behind the schedule. Sorry for the inconvenience. But I don't think, you know, some of staffs will resign, but most of them don't resign. Of course, they apologize. But it is true that, you know, punctuality is very important in Japanese society, and social responsibility is very good. Yes, that's right. Please.
How westernized is Japan? This is my first question, and also I want to kind of comment on what Professor Harry was saying a while ago about the Japanese creativity. I think this is one of the accusations directed against the Japanese, because in terms of fast production, the Americans cannot compete with the Japanese. So they come up with the idea that, you know, though the Japanese act faster, the Americans are more creative. But, you know, capitalism has designed the people, and, you know, out of this, like, sort of totalitarian understanding, you don't have much of a creativity. If you're talking about the elites, they are everywhere. Thank you.
Thank you very much. How Japan was westernized? It's difficult, but if you visited Tokyo or other cities of Tokyo, Japan, you feel that, you know, Japanese city is perfectly the same as London or Paris or even New York. Of course, the number of high buildings are different, but as the functionality, Japan westernized a lot. And regarding creativity, it is true that, you know, Japan didn't think of, haven't thought of creativity so much. But I think the situation is changing. And for example, in 1950s, Japanese were criticized as, you know, you are always imitating the product of United States or in France. But now, you know, we put, you know, many records of enterprise and so on. But I think we should change more. And, you know, after 1990, Japanese economy was not doing very well. Although Prime Minister Abe recently recovered a bit. This is because of the lack of creativity. I think Japan should overcome.
I have a question regarding the relation between society and the political elites. I mean, are the citizens really involved and interested in politics, or do they just let it go? I mean, is there mutual trust between the political elites and between the random citizens?
Regarding mutual trust, not so much. It is a bit strange from the viewpoint of democracy. In Japan, the power of bureaucrats, government officials are very big. So whoever the top politicians are, Japan can manage very good. Some people criticize Japan as, you know, bureaucrats dominated society. In a sense, it's true. But now the young politicians, there are many young good politicians, and they are trying to change the situation, you know, top-down method, like United States or some other Western countries. You know.
Yes. My name is Abdifa. I am a student of international relations. And I come from Kenya.
Kenya.
I would like to ask you a question. The question is Japan's relations with the African countries, mostly East African countries. When we compare the relationship of the East and the West, we congratulate the Japanese government. Because Japanese government has shown us a much responsibility, a much being responsible than any other country, without the interference of our foreign policies, without the interference of our domestic policies. And for that, I just want to ask you, how and what promises do you take for us in terms of economic promises and in terms of economic development with the relationship between Japan and Africa?
Good question. Honestly speaking, Japan has been put much emphasis on the relation with Asian countries and Western countries. But I think the situation is changing. Japan held a big conference on Africa, TICAD, last year. And Prime Minister Abe visited 10 African countries. The official development, we have been giving a huge amount of official ODA, you know, the official development aid, grant or money. But now Japanese government thinks it's not enough. They have to treat African companies as you know, a friend and partner to develop each other. So I think our stance to African countries is getting better by looking from your side.
Another question: Japan is also seeking the permanent membership of the United Security Council. Is it like that?
No. Japan is not a permanent member.
Is seeking currently.
Seeking. Yeah. Yes.
It's seeking. So I am asking that if the Japan, what kind of reforms they might table to the United Security Council? What reforms can you table to the United?
It is the stance of Japanese government that the system of P5 is not enough. In considering the current, you know, circumstances. So our stance is to expand the membership, you know, not only Japan, from, you know, African countries or South American countries. But, you know, honestly speaking, China is not, you know, supporting our goal. So. In this sense, it might be a difficult for Japan to get permanent member status soon. Okay. Last question. Okay, please.
Regarding my first question, what kind of investigations would you do if you were a Bosnian to increase GDP of Bosnia? I mean, it's easy to talk to increase in GDP of Bosnia as a foreigner. I am a Turkish student.
Mm-hmm.
And if you were a Bosnian, what would you do to increase in GDP of Bosnia? What kind of investigations would you do?
Yes, if I were Bosnia, it's difficult. But but you know, it seems to me that Bosnia is lacking basic infrastructure. Yes, the road condition is not very good, and the highway is only 40 kilometers. So I think you have to, Bosnia have to invest infrastructure at first. And Bosnia should invite, it's difficult to make, you know, a big scale company from the beginning. So I think it's easier to invite foreign companies. I think Poland did very good. But for doing that, I think, as I talked earlier, political stability is very important to attract foreign investment. So this is the pattern of the development of South Asian countries about 20 or 30 years ago. They constructed many infrastructure and invited foreign companies. Malaysian style, Mahathir, Mr. Mahathir did a great job as he talked at Business Forum last year. Okay, thank you very much.
Please, one moment. I would just like to invite the president of the International University's Intercultural Communication Club, the ICC, our student, Mr. Furkan Özdil, to present a plaque to His Excellency, Mr. Ambassador. And thank you all for a great Q&A. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Oh, thank you.